standing by.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this, your Sunday sunset safari. That's called triple alliteration, and it... magnificent South Africa, the iconic Kruger National Park, part of the Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park, 8.5 million acres of untrammeled wildlife wonderland. Now, my name is James Henry. On camera today is Dave. Hello, David. David is a... semi-camouflaged, and on the other vehicle we have Byron Sorrell, who looks like a buffalo and indeed is as big as a buffalo, and Brian Hijoubert, who is a bit like a giraffe, really, giraffe and the buffalo together. Now, we are traditionally supposed to start the show with an animal, a live animal, but because we are live, and live we are, hashtag Safari Live if you want to talk to us, or questions at wildearth.tv. Well, we couldn't start with an animal because we couldn't find one. So what we've started with is what is known as the woolly caperbush. It is unusual only for the fact that there are not many of them here. In other places they are quite common, but it is quite a woolly sort of a thing, and it's been consumed by a number of caterpillars. You might be able to see there. You might also be able to see the hairs shining on the bottom of it, and that's why it's called a woolly caperbush. But soon, often it doesn't grow on its own like this. Quite often it grows on a termite mound and underneath other trees, and it produces these amazing sort of, I'm still sure many of you have seen Tarzan. It produces these huge vines that swing from the trees in very well-watered areas. And that's the woolly caperbush, Caparis of Tormentosa. Right, our plan this afternoon, everyone, is to head off towards Cheetah Plains and see if we can't replicate Byron's very good efforts yesterday of elephants and cheetah. Maybe we'll be lucky with a leopard, maybe we'll be lucky with an impala and a steenbok, who knows. But before we do that, I'm just going to drive along here because we did some testing today of our new fixed-wing drone, and I lost a tool on the way, so we're just going to drive that route and then head towards Cheetah Plains. It's good to have you on board. It's a wonderful balmy winter's afternoon, 24 degrees Celsius, which I think puts us at roughly 75 degrees Fahrenheit, if I'm not mistaken. We weren't all born with enormous brains, were we, David?
No,
we wouldn't.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Byron, and with me on camera this afternoon's drive, Brian and I are currently the perhaps, and maybe if we're lucky, some of the cubs. We're in a thick block. We did have some tracks earlier, and they headed into this area, so we're just driving through and scanning very carefully. Check these trees and really scan nothing yet. It's always tricky when you drive through these thicker areas trying to get out. James had a very successful morning with lions. We've got to show you those beautiful cubs with the lionesses and the other three lionesses on Arethusa. We're going to search this area for a while. If we don't have any luck, we may head across to Arethusa this afternoon and hopefully get those lionesses a bit more active. It is such a beautiful day. The temperature's warmed up wonderfully, and compared to this morning. This morning we were very cold in the vehicle, but it has warmed up, and I'm sure we've had a lot of activity from the animals during the day. It's now just a case of finding them. There we go, putting my driving skills to test. Don't forget to send us your question, and myself and James will get through hopefully all your questions this afternoon. Hope you are all having a wonderful Sunday, relaxing. No luck just yet. Let's check this road over here if we have any tracks. Turn around here again, find any little sign, any track. And especially on cool winter's days, like today, this morning was cool right up till about 11 o'clock, so the animals and predators, while it was a lot cooler this morning. Animals like to, especially the predators, prefer conserving the energy during the heat of the day. It's because it's very hot, it's energy sapping, so they prefer generally they do move around under the cover of darkness, especially lions and leopards. They ambush predators. Let's jump out of here quickly. Watch out. There we go. Just want to make sure we don't miss any tracks. I'm going to check very carefully while we're driving along here. This area, and I think this is where they had Karula, or the update that potentially Karula would have crossed north into Vuyatela or into Juma a day or two ago. Then again, you never know with leopards. Then again, you never know.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gharri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around. Repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can. The gharri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
sorry, everybody. What happens when you're live on safari in the African bush? You know, we really are in the middle of nowhere, so we can often lose you. Just trying to wear leopard. Nothing just yet. It's, as I mentioned earlier, the temperature's warmed up quite a lot today. It's a beautiful, beautiful afternoon. Often you handle in the shade of the big trees around here and potentially then start moving around a little bit later as it cools down, right into the evening, and then move around at night. But I don't, but he didn't have any luck either. So I think we'll just continue around here a little further and we'll check the as I said, I hope you're having a wonderful, relaxing Sunday wherever you are in the world. Johannesburg, big hello to Ian, Claire and Gail. Hope they're enjoying this afternoon show with us. Don't forget to send us your questions. It's nice soft sand along this road, so it would be easier to see fresh tracks of anything crossing in and out of this area. We've got some elephant tracks already from earlier today. No sign of anything else. We haven't really seen much yet this afternoon, but it goes like that at times. As I always say, it's too soon to panic. You never know what we're going to bump into along the way. Hyena constantly move around, especially in this area. There seems to be a very... They will be looking for potential food that they could in this area. The hyenas do hunt for themselves, but
sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Again, these gremlins affecting our signal, but I think we're good now. It should be 100%. We are in the area where those crossed south into the neighboring property. That's where James was with you this morning. I was hoping we'd see them crossing back, but I don't see any tracks coming back. Cubs around with those females. Really wonderful, wonderful sighting. It was definitely a baby morning this morning. We had a lot of youngsters. James had the cubs. I had that very, very young Nyala that we found, the baby Nyala, the newborn, in fact. It was definitely born this morning, early sometime, and the mother was still busy cleaning it, and it was incredible to see. Very, very special sighting. Sean in South Africa has asked us a question. He has asked us, do we know what is the only flying animal? I wonder if you mean mammal. Flying mammal? Good question. This is tricky. There is a squirrel which there's a tree squirrel which has a flap underneath its front and hind legs. And what it does is it leaps from one tree to another, and it opens its legs and front legs and back legs, and that flap opens up and causes. I think that is the only one that I, off the top of my head. If anyone else can think of something, please let me know. I hope that's what you're asking for, Sean. I'm just scanning very carefully as we're driving around or along this road, and driving very slowly, making sure. Really warm now, so not even the birds are chirping too much. Don't see too much bird activity. Usually early in the mornings and late in the afternoons might get a bit more bird activity, especially just before dusk. The birds all give their final call for the day before they settle down and sleep and rest for the evening. While I'm checking this road for any tracks or any sign of animals.
Does that mean we're live? Oh. Well.
Letting the signal flow smoothly. So you were about to see James with the hippo, but you're back with me. You're still checking the road for any sign of animals walking through across. I've seen a lot of elephant tracks crossing back and forwards over this road. No big cats just yet. I really would like to see Karula. I've never seen that leopard before, especially with cubs. It's something that is so special. If we don't get lucky today, maybe in the next few days we do. Find those lionesses that were at the waterhole. Hopefully they're still around there. It was a warm afternoon, so I think they possibly would have stayed in that area. Afternoon they might get up and move. So what we'll do is we'll start. Morning started like this. It was a little slow at first, but it's still the bush. You know, the odd bird calling here and there. If I hear one close enough, I'll point. James Richard has asked this area, and just give me a second, James Richard, if you don't mind. I've seen some tracks here. Some tracks driving over it, but they've crossed south across our boundary into that area. Just always with Steenbok and the Daker. I'm not too sure. It's very difficult to say. You know, from what I've seen, there are a lot more still in this greater Kruger area, and have a look. I think it would be difficult to say which there's more of. And it's not arid. They drink very, very little water. They don't have to drink every day. Hyena tracks. And but the Steenbok do. So Steenbok thrive or would do a lot better in dry conditions like this as opposed to the Daker. So I think that's possibly why I would say that. I think James is still having a bit of issues with his signal, and him and David are relaxing near a waterhole and doing some birding. is very dry here at the moment. Even I'm getting a bit parched while we drive. Not too much moving around in this heat at the moment. Job does happen, but that's why we'll start making our way towards waterholes, checking around there and see if we don't have activity. You know, animals, some people think animals will go and drink. The animals will drink any time of the day. Whenever they're thirsty, they'll go down and drink some water. Continue towards a waterhole. Let's try getting an update from James one more time. Hopefully you are lucky.
Sorry about the gremlonies that seem to be messing with the gauri repeater. I will tell you what we saw at Bivelzoek Dam. We saw a hippopotamus. He looked not displeased to see us. Then we saw two waterbuck bulls, the only waterbuck I've actually seen at the water since I've arrived at Juba. And there are a whole lot of nyala coming down. So it's a real pity you couldn't have joined us there. We also had blacksmith lapwings. We had a three-banded plover. All in all, a very good time was had by two of us at Bivelzoek Dam. Very nice Sunday afternoon. And, you can hear I'm speechless at the suggestion from Byron that I would switch the car off and just go birding on my own. I mean, I'm scandalized. Now, we were talking about favorite trees this morning. Well, in actual fact, Byron was talking his favorite trees were. I thought I'd talk about some of mine, as the ability of my good self to find animals has continued to be dire. Favorite trees, and I'm sure many of you have got favorite trees, very few of them actually occur here. One of them, the brown ivory we get here. I am also a huge fan of the Natal mahogany. It's a beautiful tree that grows sort of deeper in towards the more permanent river. There's an elephant. Stand by, everybody. Marula trees, obviously magnificent things. Then, I know this is going to scandalize people, but there's something about a standard, bog standard issue oak tree that I really, really find deeply comforting. And there, of course, the beautiful fig trees, huge fig trees that we get. And possibly my very favorite, the nyala berry. A nyala berry tree, stunning tree. No matter how often I played the hole, every time I teed off, my ball would sail straight and true into the middle. Now, they seem to be going off into torch with these elephants, which is very unkind of them. We will approach with relative speed. But there's a whole lot of them in there, just disappearing off into Torchwood. Oh, it's a nice big herd, full of big. Let me stop in the shade here. You can see them all grazing across the clearing there, and they're in the shade. Very sweet. So peaceful when they want to be, and so deeply unpeaceful when they want to be, but these ones seem to be in a relative state of peace. Feeding, and you can see the ground on which they're feeding, of course, is almost denuded of vegetation. And a forb, of course, is a sort of unidentified herbaceous plant, like a flower, really. But they still maintain a little bit of moisture in them, and that's why the elephants will be trying to pick out those. Deep blue winter sky, the last bits of green, and those great grey giants gently walking off in an easterly direction. Looks like a big bull at the back there, that's quite interesting. Big bull lurking with the herd. He'll be probably, or if he's not in must, he'll be coming into must. Between them now, the big bull behind, the cow there. Look how flat her back is in comparison with him, how her belly is less rounded. Her husks grow down more than they grow forward, and in this case, it's completely rubbish. You can see those tusks are growing forward, but they are definitely thinner at the base than a bull's will be. I mean, he's a good third again, 30% larger than the cows. He's a magnificent chap. But look how graceful that 6-ton animal is. Right, let's go a little bit forward. We might be lucky to get another view. I'll just turn a little bit. See how there's no grass ever. And that is going to make for tough times for the grazers. The two wild earth stations mobile. One went Piffleshook Dam via Garrick, about 200 metres to the north of the junction with Garry Main, and Byron's headed down south towards Treehouse Dam. So that's just an update, and for those of you who are perhaps new viewers, we are in constant radio contact with all of the game drives around this area. And oh, he didn't get that message. I will have a network of people driving around. Some can cross the borders that we can't cross, some can't. And so we are in a sort of a network of tracking communication, if you like. So if somebody sees something that we see or that we want to see, we can go there, and sometimes the other way around. So it's really important that we keep in good contact with everyone around here and maintain friendships. Otherwise, people will hide things from us. I'm just going to give him that message again. Lex, are you copying me now? Lex, two stations, Wild Earth Mobile. One went towards Treehouse Dam, the other went Garry Cutline, Biffleshook Cutline to Biffleshook Dam. Currently on Cheetah Cutline with the breeding herd of elephants mobile east into Torchwood, 200 metres north from the junction with Garry Main. That one there, just if you can go to the right there, if you don't mind. There we go. Right, there we go. Now, eating a Combretum calinum bush, a variable bush willow. Now, elephants do like those, and you can see that from the fact that, well, the elephant's eating it, of course, but you can also see that from the fact that it has been broken so many times. And if you watch carefully, that elephant is not eating the leaves. He's kind of stripping the leaves off. He's eating one or two, but he's mostly going for the bark. There, he's eating some actual leaves there. Spoken to you before, and if I haven't, well, it's good to meet you, Lucia. How do you do? You want to know, when a bull's ready to mate, does he separate the female of the object to estrus, and then she will seek out a very large bull? Well, when he's around the herd, she won't leave the herd to be with him. Then they'll kind of, they'll move away slightly, but they don't go and find sort of privacy. He cannot mate with her unless she wants to. And there, she has to almost back into him in order for them to copulate successfully, not to put too fine a point on it. And they will do that only when she's ready, and it'll be slightly away from the herd. And so I don't think he'll try and separate her from the herd, no, but he'll certainly chase her around a bit. And sometimes, just before she's actually ready to, they really do create enormous consternation within the herds, these great big bulls. But the best part of their sort of breeding cycle, I suppose, celebration for the rest of the herd. And quite unlike many other herding animals, where the new mother must sort of separate herself and she becomes extremely vulnerable while her baby is being born, or while it's sort of in its first half an hour before it can stand up and run around, the elephants will surround the cow, will help to pick the little one up when it is finally born. And it's this huge, sort of almost human, if you like, celebration when the little baby elephant is born afterwards. James Dungan, a very good question, which we will answer with an experiment. We will feed David two pieces of moisture content And when the moisture content goes, so will the carbohydrates go. So a lot more just structural stuff in the dry leaves. But let's have a taste of the difference. I'm sure we'll be able to get it. These elephants are heading off into Torchwood. I'm not going to get actually do it just right over here. I'll hide from them using the car. David, if they come rushing out of Torchwood, you will tell me, won't you? Sort of gold one, one brown one. Well, we'll get two, Dave. We'll have one each. And two greenies. Now, this is the... So it's the same kind of tree. Right, now, David, here is your treat for the day. Say thank you.
Mmm, delicious. Mm-hmm.
Right, let's go with the greenie first. But there is some moisture. You can taste nutrients, I suppose. Not nice.
What's next,
James? Next, let's go with the gold. Golden delicious. That was Granny Smith. Now... Almost entirely tasteless, wouldn't you say?
I would say.
Totally tasteless. So all of those substances have gone, but while the tannins, which are not great for the animals to eat, have disappeared. You know, like straw, like dusty straw. Not much to recommend any of them. So there we go, James. A profound difference in taste between the Granny Smith, the Golden Delicious, and the Withered and Dead. To find an animal, or if he's still talking nonsense and casting aspersions on my character.
There's an impala. And there it moves. Hang on, they're just around the corner. Three male impala. So I have found an animal, James. We are in the area where there were three lionesses this morning. They cleared a whole drainage line with one leap, very, very easily. So we are in this area where the lionesses were this morning, three lionesses. I've seen signs of their tracks, or I've seen their tracks heading west, away from the waterhole. They are not lying there anymore. I was hoping they would have been lying down, but they have... Keep our eyes open, moving in through a drainage line, so it's nice and we're in here. I will be very, very excited if we find these lionesses. Trying to look for tracks. There's a lot of impala around here, so That's a good sign. It means that it's unlikely that there are lionesses. We'll check further down this area. Come, I need to find you something. It's my favorite. And it's so hot, it's lovely to drive and all just spend some time in these riverbeds, these dry riverbeds. Nuts.
Gone the whole way there. Hello, everybody. Sorry about that. There was another elephant that we saw. Unfortunately, he is in very thick bush, so we're going to carry on here. Now, we are not allowed to go either north or south of this road because we're on the way to Cheetah Plains now. But maybe there is something exceptional. Good afternoon. How are you? Good, how are you?
Fine, thank you. Can't complain.
No, good. Doesn't help this morning that you heard about?
I wasn't out on drive this morning, okay. So I know Mike's been driving around there, but nothing else, eh?
Cool.
We're trying to find those skunk apparently from yesterday.
All right, cool.
No horns are coming towards our side.
Cool. All righty. So that's Peter from Nkoro, which is just to the north of Cheetah Plain. So I seem to be finishing every sentence like that. There is a starling, David, a bird on a wire. Which I think is a film, isn't it? There we are. Beautiful always to see a starling in the sunlight, because they are so very pretty. That looked. Oh, it is a virtual starling. You can see it with no black. No, it's not. It's got an orange eye. There we go. The bird on the wire has flown off. Cape glossy starling. It went as it went away. Just trying to listen to. Apparently, Tundi was seen sometime this morning. Mike, what was the last? Okay, so she was apparently. Remember when we saw her? I don't know if you remember. We saw her. Copy, thanks. We saw her on, lying there when we drove past here the other day. And now, apparently, she was on the termite mound underneath that, but she did then head north. Now, we all guessed, given that Jamie saw her in the same tree 2 days later, now they've seen her on this termite mound again, and I wonder if Tundi, Karula's other daughter, has not given birth somewhere around here. What I'm going to do, termite mound in front of us there. So you've got the telegraph pole and the termite mound down straight through the other side there. If you super zoom in on the top of that, yeah, you actually go off-road around here, because it is not our place. No, that isn't a leopard, this is a tree, a bush. Okay, let's roll down the hill. Byron, where we can look at it down in this gap here. See you shortly. Tally-ho, David.
And I've had no luck finding any sign of these lionesses. But I'm not giving up just yet. We are going to search. And I know when you saw them this morning, they were lying down and thought, well, that's it, they're going to stay here for today. Just shows you can never, ever. Well, while you were with James, just trying to see if I can't find any tracks. But alas, no luck. Good afternoon, Monique from London. Welcome. Monique, yes, we are looking for those three Nkuruma females that James found this morning. Rate them and find them, but they've moved off. And I cannot seem to find an exact direction. There's a lot of vehicle activity there, so a lot of tracks have been driven over. This is the exciting part. This very, very exciting. But you never know. Check these junctions in a road. As we saw a few nights ago, the night before, we saw a lioness and we followed her and we saw how they use the roads, and it's just a nice pathway, the path of least resistance. There's not a lot of trees and it's just a great way to get around. Often in the soft sand, if you're lucky, you get a glimpse of a track. It's not to say they're not going to walk off. So Finn, aged 8, has asked us, do apples be growing out in the wild, the normal apples? We've got a lot of other fruit though, and one of the very well-known fruit is the marula fruit. But in summer, A lot of trees bear different fruits. Another one is a sour plum. Very, very, very sour fruit. And I've tried sour plum. But no apples. I think the elephant are a little bit unhappy about that. Don't you think so, Finn? Good things come to those with persistence, I think. What do you think? I wish I had a good friend of mine, a guy by the name of Judas. Him and I worked together for a long time. He was the tracker that I used to work with. Went of animals very, very well. And someone like that with you, while you're driving, see half a track. And very, very easily. It was incredible, and I learned so much from him. I'm sure if Judas was with us now, we'd have a little bit more luck finding his lions. So you're two. But while he does that, stick with me a little bit, just a little bit longer. It's always interesting to see. You never know, we could get out, have a... Sandra, I wouldn't say a dangerous close encounter. I have had some encounters that I've had to be a little bit more careful with, and that comes from tracking and looking for animals. When you are tracking, you're walked into leopard, and usually they give a bit of a growl, and as soon as I hear that, I tend to back off. I see there's some other guys trying to give us a hand. So Sandra, as I was saying, you've got to be so careful when you are tracking, because you often bump into these animals you're looking for, but often you really threaten them, they may charge you. I haven't been charged yet, but I've been growled at quite a few times. So, but I guess that's part of the job. Just want to reverse a little bit here quickly. Those guys are checking in the same drainage line looking for tracks or following tracks. You can drive around, take the next road around and see if those tracks don't come out somewhere. It will cut down the time you spend tracking. It really... Checking carefully around here. Incident, actually, Sandra, now that I think about it, another incident I did have many. And an elephant in camp is not a bad thing, but it's not ideal, especially during the day. Excuse me. Especially during the day.